A very warm good afternoon to everyone. It's an honor to be here, and I must thank the awesome community of Python User Group Singapore, and special thanks to Mr. Ji Sung Chi and Ivan. They always motivate and keep encouraging me. I really love this city, and this is my fifth time to Singapore, and like every time, today also I met some amazing people, and with them I had some really amazing heartwarming surprises. In the beginning I met a small kid. I wanted to find a way to cross the road and go to the other side, to the next bus stop. I just asked him to show me a way. Instead of just telling me the direction, that kid came with me all the way to the other side, and with a very, very, very amazing smile, he said bye to me and went back. One more incident happened. In the morning at MRT station, I wanted to get my ticket from the ticket vending machine, and I did not have small currency. I was not able to get that ticket. I was like confused and thinking, looking everywhere. A senior lady came to me. She understood my problem, okay, and she paid for my ticket. And when I asked her, how do I pay your money now? She just said, don't worry about it, man. But when you find somebody somewhere in trouble, just help him. So there is a lot to learn from you all. Singapore is an inspiration. Singaporeans are an inspiration for me. Thank you very much for being what you are. Now coming back to my talk. You will find the answer why such odd slide in the beginning at the end of my talk. I'll be sharing some stories where Python really helped us. Python really helped us to change the way we teach and learn physics. Applicable to almost all the subjects, but because I'm a physics teacher, I'll be talking about these things. Unfortunately, almost everywhere in my country, science is taught only from the books without giving much importance to the experiments. We do only theory. For years, printed textbook is typically the central component of courses like physics. But physics is a subject of change, and static textbooks and just classroom activities cannot convey that change effectively. Let's have a little discussion about this before I move on to the next slide. Many times in my first class of the year, I ask this question to my students: what is the most boring and difficult subject that you had in high school? I teach to pre-university classes, and the typical answer is physics. Some people say maths, but most of the times people say physics is the most difficult and boring subject. Now, what's wrong with these subjects? Why physics is so difficult and boring? Is the subject really difficult, or teachers make it difficult? Let's try and explore. Typically in a physics class, how do we start teaching physics? Like, consider a body. Let there be a force acting on the body. Body gets some acceleration. So everything hypothetical. In teacher's conceptual model, body has reached somewhere there. Students are still searching, trying to understand, trying to visualize. And we derive so many mathematical equations on the board. Newton's laws, quantum mechanics. In the end, when student reaches his home, they find no relation between whatever they have done in the classroom and their real life. That link is missing. We don't know why are we studying these things, where exactly we are going to utilize these things in our life. And that is the most important question that we must understand and answer before we start studying something. We must appreciate the importance of that subject. we must appreciate the beauty of those equations, and then things will be easy. Now, I'm not able to put it in proper words, but sometimes physics teachers aren't just boring, they are ineffective too. And that results in loss of interest among students. They experience difficulties in understanding the concept and the principles of physical world that are sometimes impossible to see. Let's take an example of concepts like electricity. We introduce concepts of electricity to students when they are in fifth and sixth grade. Electromagnetic induction, interference of sound, and later on Fourier series. We just do all these things on the board, and students learn it just by reading things. So what are the problems that our education system is facing now? Most important thing is passive learning. Then, at least from the part of the world from where I come, exam-oriented education system, sometimes lack of equipment, sometimes lack of motivation, and absolutely no scope for exploration and experiential learning. Students, when they pass high school and come to pre-university at 11th standard, I ask them these basic questions. Do you know what is AC and DC? Students are comfortable with the answers. But then if you ask them, have you ever tried to produce electricity? Have you ever tried to do something with it on your own? And generally answers are no. And then there is one more problem. Sometimes we teachers kill the inherent curiosity that a kid has. Instead of encouraging students to ask questions, we avoid those questions. We ask them to keep their mouth shut. Sometimes we say it's not there in the syllabus or it's out of the syllabus. And sometimes these kind of things also happen. If a student is asking proof for something, and what is the end result? Because we do only theory, and just boring mathematical equations, and no scope for experiential learning, no scope for learning by doing. So the result is students who think that science is only for smart people, students whose imaginations are unmoved by Saturn's rings, quadratic equations, implications of special theory of relativity, and people who take gravity as not as something which is amazing. I have always wished if I could take my entire laboratory to the classroom and demonstrate each and every single thing to the students. Instead of just teaching them on the board, show them what it is. Give them some toys so that they can learn by themselves. And later I tried some experiments to solve these problems. And as a part of taking laboratory to the classroom, the first thing that I did is I started using toys made by waste material, toys from trash. Okay, that first photograph is of Mr. Arvind Gupta, a famous person who has spent his entire life in designing toys for kids, science toys for kids. And the second thing that I came across is a pocket science lab fully powered by Python programming language called XPies. Experiments for Young Engineers and Scientists. And of course, Python programming language made my life very easy. And the latest version of XPies is called Pocket Science Lab. Let me show you something. When we teach electricity to the kids, one simple science toy that can be used, that can demonstrate how electricity is produced. I am using a simple coil here, coil made up of copper wire. And then at the ends, one small LED is connected. We all know this simple concept of electromagnetic induction. When we take a magnet and move it inside a coil, or if a conductor is moving in a magnetic field, electricity is generated. That is a very simple concept. So I'll be using this magnet, and I'll just drop it in this coil. And just to guide it, I'm using this pipe made up of paper. Now, definitely electricity will be generated, and you will be able to see that. Okay, I'll just do like this. Can you see this LED glowing? Right? I'm just moving a magnet in a coil, okay, and that resultant effect is seen. So if these kind of toys are introduced to the kids before we actually teach them in the classroom, definitely their understanding will be better. And the next thing that comes in mind is, if this electricity is generated, what kind of electricity is that? Can we plot a graph for it? Can we understand how the amplitude of the electricity is changing with time? And here definitely Python helps. I use our Pocket Science Lab for demonstrating all these things. Simply you can connect this coil to that simple toy that you can see there on that laptop, and it can easily fetch data. It can take like a couple of hundreds of readings in few microseconds, and it can plot that graph. And for plotting the graph, again, Python is just like two or three lines of code, and you'll be able to plot amazing graphs. Yeah, this is the latest version of our Pocket Science Lab. And why Python? Now, most of the teachers like me in India, they have zero background in computing knowledge. We learn a little bit of C programming in master degree, and that is the end of it. Now, with such backgrounds, learning a new programming language, imagine, okay, if you want to plot some graph, show some visual animation in C or other programming language, it's very difficult. But Python makes the job easy. You'll have to just import a ready-made library, write one line of code, and Python does the job for you. So you need not worry about all the technical details. You don't need to learn everything from Python. You just need to know your equations and how to visualize it using Python. This is the comic from XKCD that we had on our Pi Belgaum t-shirt. It's like import anti-gravity and start flying. Python is literally easy like this. It has many other advantages also. Easy to learn and very powerful, and includes a range of features for scientific computing, handling vectors, matrices. You can easily plot 3D graphs also. While teaching mathematics, this can be a very handy tool. For example, when we introduce such equations to kids, sine 3x, we just mug up, bahat. But how about showing that equation to a kid? Make visualizations for these equations so that kids can understand what that 3 is doing in the equation. What is the role of x in the equation? If I slightly change the equation, how the graph looks like? Maybe let's try doing this. It's just a, you can see it's hardly 3-line program. I can reduce 2 more lines there. We just need x variable, that's the linear space. Then we need our mathematical equation for plotting the graph, and just say plot x, y. And that library in PyLab is doing this job of showing us showing the graph to us. Let me see if I can do this. Just a second, please. My mouse is giving me trouble here. Is it there? Yeah. Okay, so the first equation is 3-line code. And it plots a beautiful graph for you. You don't need to worry about all the technical details. And then when I change that equation, added that extra factor 3 multiplied by the function. You can immediately see the change. There are many other examples that can be shown. Okay, simplest thing that we come across in mechanics is a spring loaded with mass. oscillations of loaded spring. Yeah, it's here. Okay, now in the code, if kids can just change simple variables in the equation, they can actually see the effect that is happening. On one side, oscillations are damping. On the other side, the damping factor is not there. So while teaching all these things, damped oscillations and normal oscillations, if we use these small code snippets from Python, we can show better visual models. Let me show one more. Okay, a charged particle thrown in magnetic field. If a charged particle is projected in the magnetic field like orthogonally, it will have a circular trajectory. Change the angle, the trajectory will change. If you wish to write this animation program in any other language, you will have to write at least few hundred lines. But Python, it's again like 10-15 lines maximum. This is power of Python. It's a very small, simple code. Okay, let us go back to the presentation. Okay, this is about the equations. That one more example is of bouncing ball. Okay, there is no limit here. You can visualize anything and everything. Okay, here that small code snippet is for visualizing motion of planets around the sun. And the other is for Lorentz animation. Okay, and the experiments that my students did with the Pocket Science Lab, we could use a small sensor, SRF, ultrasonic sensor, and with a few lines of code, they could plot position time graphs. We study these position time graphs in 11th grade. Okay, they try and understand relationship between velocity time graph, position time graph, and acceleration time graph. So once we thought of how about actually doing this experiment, so with this Pocket Science Lab and a small Python code and a very low cost piezo sensor, we could do this experiment, and that was a very fun activity. Like, students will have to just take some obstacle like a book and just start moving in front of that sensor and give them like tasks. Okay, plot a graph which is linear in nature. Plot a graph which is exponentially increasing. Plot a graph which is exponentially decreasing. Plot a graph where velocity is constant. Plot a graph where velocity is continuously increasing. So they could do all these experiments just by playing with one sensor and Python code. That last example is of combining two signals to produce different patterns. Okay, this thing which I had demonstrated in the beginning, just a magnet falling in a coil. Electricity generated. So what should be the nature of that? Again, using Python, you can do this job very easily. You can see that curve that is obtained by taking readings. In the beginning, when the magnet is moving towards the coil, electricity is generated, and that has one direction. And suddenly, when the magnet is going away from the coil, direction of electricity generated should be opposite. And you get that interesting graph there. Then kids can play with changing the size of the magnet, changing the number of turns in the coil, changing the direction of the coil, adding multiple coils, and they can understand everything about electromagnetism. Okay, how the rate of change of magnetic field is related with the produced EMF or electricity. So I think these are the best possible tools to provide provide scope for experiential learning in any classroom. These are some of the experiments that we did with sound. We have two simple piezo buzzers there producing sine waves. And when they are combined, they are added. Okay, we are just picking up that signal using a small mic and plot it together. You can see that amplitude variation in the sound. And this is one more very simple experiment. Again, a very low cost. Okay, in Indian currency, the cost of this experiment was like hardly 100 rupees. We have two oscillating pendula. They are coupled with a spring. And when you oscillate them, you can oscillate them in different styles. In fact, all these results are produced by our students. I just demonstrated them one idea, but they came with 3-4 other new things. For example, if I keep one pendulum steady and just start oscillating the other, then what will happen is the energy from the second pendulum will be transferred to the first, and then from the first to the second, and that happens periodically. So you can see there in the first graph that is plotted, when the amplitude in the first graph is maximum, amplitude in the second graph is minimum. And it's amazing to see that happening in reality and also on the screen. Python is just plotting a graph for you in real time. So first pendulum starts decreasing the amplitude. Simultaneously, amplitude of the second pendulum will start increasing. And then that keeps on happening periodically. You can set them to oscillate in phase, means both of them are going together, or both of them are going out of phase, right? Mathematical equations for these graphs are very complicated for an 11th grade student. But if you can show them this thing in real life, it really becomes easy. Okay, so graphs are plotted separately and then together. Another example that experiment that we tried is motion on air track. So you can reduce the friction, make it almost zero, and study all Newton's laws. This is for Lissajous figures. While showing this to 8th class students, I use sine waves. One kid stood up and said, "Sir, why can't we use square waves?" I said, "Go ahead and do it." And then they produce some amazing patterns using this. These are the patterns produced by adding two square waves. And this is by like 8th standard kid. He used the same code, just changed the waves, sine to square. Okay, and one more group of 10th standard could do these things. Why I'm explaining all these things is just to convey you that these things are really very easy, and they're easy because of power of Python. So they could set up a small weather station with humidity sensor, wind sensor, temperature sensor, and they could get that data automatically tweeted, of course using the Twitter API. Okay, I got opportunity to work with FOSS Asia for my GSOC project, and this is our latest device, Pocket Science Lab. This has additional capabilities, multiple sources, and it can also fetch data from wireless sensors. Okay, to conclude, the devaluing of physical exploration and growing sense of discontinuation with the physical world is a major problem of our educational system. And definitely effective use of Python can eliminate these things and promote experiential learning. So definitely it has a potential to change the way we teach and learn physics, or for that matter, any other subject. And in the beginning, I had one simple slide like this. I think I lost it, right? Okay. There is a saying, there is a quote by Walter Levin. This mouse is giving some problem. Okay, it's here. You can change that word physics by any other subject, and I truly believe this. Okay, because when students carry a bad impression about the subject, it's not because of the subject, and it's most of the time because of the teacher. And how to save ourselves? Python is there to help. There are many other ways also. So thank you very much for your patient hearing, listening to me. If you have any questions, please. So basically our idea was not like learn to code. It was like code to learn. So learn coding not as a separate subject, but when you're studying physics, some phenomena, to do that, whatever is required, just take it from Python, automatically Python coding will happen. Say for example, if I want to plot a sine graph, I just need to write, okay, I don't teach them like what are the way computer programming language is taught. Okay, starting from all the details, basics of that language, then variables and other keywords, then loops, right? So we directly start by writing our first program, not defining anything. Okay, so you just need to define a variable x, y, and say plot x, y. And then tell them how that plot x, y thing is happening. So that plot x, y thing is being done by a library somewhere in Python. And then they need to know how to import that library. For that, what you should do? Import this. So we don't go in details of Python. Okay, so we just take whatever simple steps are required in the beginning. Huh, I forgot one more thing. Then there is one tool that we devised. One of my friends wrote this code. Okay, I understood the problem. It's like mirrored. So we added all these simple code snippets in a single tool so that kids who are interested in learning like Python can learn everything on their own. Okay, it's... So all this exercise resulted in this amazing tool. Okay, it's like Python code browser. And with some suggestions and help from my friends here in Singapore, we are trying to modify this, make it Python 3 compatible, make the code little more readable. You all can also help us with this. It's hosted on GitHub. Okay, so this is very, just a second. Okay. So here we have some simple basic programs, like the starter program. And this is how kids can learn. So we have a very simple program here, value of pi, take radius as the input, and print the area, calculate and print. So you just have your constant, whatever variable you want to accept from the keyboard, equation, and print. And just execute. So here, enter the radius and calculate. So next level will be going for plotting. Okay, let me go to one simple example. For example, Fourier series. Okay, so we have here first harmonics added here to sine. This is a sine wave. Sine wave, everybody knows how it looks like. But if I add the first harmonic, what exactly happens? So the shape of the sine wave will change. So to do all these things, they just need those 3-4 lines. And they can change the parameters which are there in the program. So just trial and error method, like make that 3, replace it by 4. Or you can add one more harmonic here. Okay, second harmonic for a Fourier series is like 5x by 5. Now let's see how that wave changes. And if you go on adding the harmonics here, that sine wave will take a shape of a square wave. So this is like the easiest way to show Fourier series. And again, when you go on adding, you try and filter components from a complex wave, you will get those frequencies. That is Fourier transform. So when I learned it, everything was like a bouncer, everything above head. Like I could never see these things on the graph. And here I have a graph which is plotting everything like a magic. I just need to use one line from Python. And those visual animations which you could see, those are from Python Visual. There is one more library called MayaV. And one more amazing tool that can be used easily if you want to show multiple graphs is matplotlib. So if I have matplotlib, Pylab, and Python Visual, most of the problems can be solved. Each and everything that is there in the physics textbook can be animated, can be made interactive, and it can be fun also. So kids can just open any program, try and understand how it is working, just change the parameters, say execute, and then they will develop the interest and they will start going in details. Then they will have to buy maybe a Python book and start studying. I hope that answers your question. Okay, if there are no other questions, thank you very much. Thanks for the opportunity.